Welcome everybody to episode 4 or 5 of Headroom. We're calling this technically episode 4, even though we've done a bunch of two-part episodes which get chunked into various bits and pieces. My name is Jonathan Weiner. I am coming to you from the slightly snowy People's Republic of Cambridge, Massachusetts. We're still dealing with winter here, but not for much longer. That's my hope. For those of you who are new, or even for those of you who are not, we are archiving any episode that we do here on the iZotope website. Right now you can find it under the Community tab and then go down to the Events tab and you'll see links to previous episodes. And in previous episodes, I've built the show around a particular theme, around loudness, around acoustics and improving your studio environment and protecting your hearing, and had guest speakers join me to add a new voice and a expert perspective on these things. And I will continue to do that in the future. But for this episode, we'd received so many questions which indicated interest about particular subjects that are more along the lines of a how-to, like how do I think about adjusting level or making my my record louder, or how do I protect my hearing, or how do I think about hearing loss over time and audio production, et cetera, et cetera. So we thought it might be nice to dedicate an entire episode to those questions. I promise I won't get to all the questions. There are way, way, way too many of them, but what I'm going to try to do is at least amalgamate some of them, because a lot of them fall into similar themes, hopefully address a bunch of questions with single answers, but then we'll pull out individual questions and hop around topics as well. So this may be a little bit ADD. We'll see how it goes. Lars Wicklund is here and he's joining me.
Hey, everyone.
And he's going to kind of be your voice. So he's got a record of every question that's been answered or asked rather thus far. Feel free to add new ones into the chat window. We also have a podcast series called the New Audio Podcast that's hosted by Sean Greenhall, and he's going to be joined by Jeff Manchester, and he does more sort of artist-oriented material, but I invite you to have a look for that because it's kind of the artist side of what we do here, and what we do here is a little bit more based on audio production. So, hopping right in, before I start answering individual questions, I thought what I would do, since there were so many that were in the domain or the subject area of levels, that I might just do a quick piece about level. And when we talk about level, what the language is that we use, the vocabulary, and maybe that will help answer a bunch of questions all at once and inform some of the other answers that might come up. So let me... let's see, share screen, here we go. And let's go over here. All right. So I want to talk to you a little bit about level. And I'm going to go through this really, really fast. But in the audio universe, there are a couple of really important concepts to keep in mind whenever we're talking about level. One is, I'm going to draw this sort of abstracted line here. We're going to call that distortion. And here is the level where your audio is, right? Where the average level or the sustained level or the predominant level of your audio is. And I'm going to draw one more line down below, and we're going to call that noise or the noise floor. Okay? So distortion, and we're talking about, technically speaking, talking about technical systems. We're not talking about guitar distortion or good kinds of distortion. We're talking about the kind of distortion that you generally want to avoid. So distortion is this line you don't want to cross here. And then, so your audio is going to sit somewhere lower, and the distance between the audio level and distortion we call headroom. How about that? More about that later. Noise, or the noise floor that sits down here, is generally undesirable. It's not good noise. It's noise that can distract you from the audio, by and large. And so what we try to do is keep the music far enough away from noise, right, so that the noise isn't noticeable, and yet not so close to distortion that we end up wrecking the audio, right? Some basic concepts there. Please excuse me if this is obvious to everybody out there, but I think it's important to define these terms. All right. So now when we are recording or performing audio, obviously audio is not just a steady state signal that stays at a certain level, right? It undulates, it gets louder and quieter. And when you look at signals, you usually see transients and you see lower level audio in between the transients. That looks like shark fins. Anyway, okay, so the tip of the shark fins here, right, the thing that gets close to distortion is the peak level, right? And then the sustained level, the level that sustains over time, we like to sometimes call average level. There are a bunch of other words that we can use that are a little bit more technical to describe it, and we can get into that in a little while. But what's really important about these two definitions, about peak and average, or sustained level, is that the peak level is most important because it tells us how close we are to distortion. So we want to measure that, right? In any instant, we want to measure the peak level. But the average, but our the interesting thing is that peak level really doesn't have any specific pitch or meaning in terms of musical values. The thing that has meaning in terms of the musical value, by and large, is sustained level. Our ears window audio over a period of time, generally accepted to be about a third of a second, in order to help us evaluate both loudness and to evaluate things like pitch. Right. If you take a look here, I'm going to swap screens here for a moment and go over to, let's see, let me go here. Oh, it didn't want to do that, did it? Let's see, go here. Here we go. Okay. So if you take a look at this screen, you can actually see the individual sample points. And it's essentially the sample points are just a couple of sample points in quick sequence that are used to evaluate peak level, right? But a sample point doesn't have any pitch. Pitch is something that happens over time, okay? And so if we're looking for some information about pitch and musical values, we're usually looking at waveforms and signals that last much longer than that. So maybe that's sort of a quick preamble to define some terms. We can talk a little bit in answering questions about RMS level versus LUFS versus LKFS. We can talk a little bit about how that this relates to audio production. But let me just stop there. And Lars, I think I'd like to turn to you and invite the first question.
Yeah. Our first question is actually from an anonymous user, but it's most engineers argue on whether to record at 96 kilohertz or a higher sampling rate or not. Many think it's useless. How do these frequencies influence the frequencies we hear, and do we really hear them?
All right. So should we record at high sample rates is the question.
Yeah.
So again, setting some foundational sort of knowledge, level setting, it's generally accepted. There's some theories here that are generally accepted until disproven. One is that we can only hear up to 20K, theoretically, right? In fact, I would assert that the only people who can hear up to 20K are, as a class, generalizing, probably teenage girls. Once you get older, you start to lose your acuity. Males don't have as good high frequency acuity as females, but you can only hear up to about 20,000 hertz. And in order to capture 20,000 hertz, we need to have a sample rate of at least 40,000 hertz. 44.1K is what we usually use. 48K is associated with video. But those are the most commonly used sample rates, or maybe the minimally acceptable sample rates for audio production. So you look at ADD converters, you look at DAWs, and they all offer these higher sample rates. So why? You know, why are they doing it? Is it a conspiracy to get us to part with our money?
Maybe.
Maybe. It could be. I suspect that there may be something to it more than that. And in fact, I believe that there is. Before I start talking about this from the standpoint of fidelity or quality of audio, one of the things I want to say is anytime you make decisions about the spec of your audio, obviously there are workflow considerations that come into play. In other words, if you have a 100 channel mix session and you're working on a 5-year-old laptop, you may not have the processing power in your computer to run sample rates higher than 44.1 and run your full 100 channel mix session, especially if you're adding a lot of EQ and compression or a couple of instances of reverb. So sometimes workflow and real world considerations will drive an answer to that question. There are some other reasons why you might choose to use 44.1 or 48K depending on what kind of processing you're doing. But here's the thing. Using sample rates that are higher than 44.1 or 48K will not, the benefit of those is not that they will allow you to hear frequencies above 20K. The benefit is that what you can hear up to 20K will sound better. And that's because of the nature of A to D conversion and sampling. And it's also because of the benefits that you get from certain kinds of signal processing. Let me just give you a quick example of this. And there are several different reasons to point out here, but let's look again at this example. All right, so what we're seeing here is samples that are happening every 1/44,000th time per second, all right? So these data points. Now, if you were to, I'm just changing the samples to illustrate this point. I've got a small peak, a rise in this signal. It happens very quickly, and you can see that there's a sample point here and a sample point here, but there's a peak level in between those two samples, and the blue line that you're seeing is the analog signal that you will hear. That's what gets reproduced by the D to A converter that you're listening to. That is higher than the level of the individual sample points. Now, this is an instantaneous peak. It produces a bump in level that is very, very short duration. But if you're using a processor like a peak limiter, for instance, it would be nice if that peak limiter could actually evaluate the real peak to know how often to work and to know what the maximum signal level is likely to be on playback. So if you were to use a sample rate that's faster, it would be as if I was inserting another sample right in the middle. And then I would catch that peak. So one of the benefits of using 96 kilohertz or 88.2 kilohertz is that you get better tracking of absolute signal transients. There are other benefits that accrue for EQing. And maybe the other benefit that I would point to, or the other benefit that I would absolutely point to, not maybe, is that when you're doing an A to D conversion, using a higher sample rate means that the processing required to get the signal from analog into digital is kinder and gentler and of a higher fidelity. And then you can manipulate the signal in the digital domain in the box after the fact and probably do a better job, get a higher fidelity signal as a result. So the point is, if you use sample rates higher than 44.1 or 48K, you will end up with a better fidelity signal in the box. Okay, so that's sort of the answer to your question. I'm going to add and then. If you're producing music for iTunes, if you're producing music for that's going to end up on YouTube, at some point it's going to have to go from 96K back down to 48K or 44.1. And so there will be a bit of a penalty that you incur. It will degrade the sound a little bit when you get back down to 48K or 44.1. Does that sort of degrade the audio to the point where you would have been better off starting there? And the answer, I'm sorry to say, is maybe. Depends on what you're doing. My perspective is, if I'm making a master recording, and the master, I want to have the master sound as good as possible and be the best version of the audio that I'm producing, I will start with a high sample rate and then deal with the penalty that is required by going down to 48 or 44.1. Another aside, if you were to choose sample rates above 88.2 or 96K, the advantages diminish slightly. I think you get a greater benefit by going from 44.1 to 88, expresses an overall gain, than going from 88.2 to 176, or 176 to 352, or for that matter to DSD at 2.8 megahertz. There are many sort of gradations of high-speed sample rates. So whether you get additional benefit that's worth it, again, it's sort of context specific. But I think the greatest gain is made at that first leap away from the 44 and 48 sample rates out to the double speed sample rates. So how did I do? Does that cover it?
That's great.
Okay.
Going back to Headroom for a second, we had a user named Nick who wanted to know, how do you get the most bass in a mix without taking up all the headroom?
How do you get the most bass without taking up all the headroom? So it's an interesting question. My thinking about it for a moment, I think that the thing that I find that people struggle with when they're dealing with low frequency content in their mix is their monitoring. It's very difficult to figure out how to manage low frequency signals if you don't have good monitoring. And you've probably heard me talk about this before. If you go to the iZotope website, there's a piece that I did, a video about monitoring that talks about that you can look up on the iZotope site. So let me see if I can illustrate this by pulling up another. Here we go, share screen. All right. So if you take a look at the audio of most recorded music that involves bass and drums, you will see that the bass region is where you'll have the highest amplitude. For those of you who are not familiar with the concept of equal loudness contours, it takes more level at 100 hertz to produce the same perceived level coming out of a speaker than it does at 1,000 hertz. So in order to get an equal loudness, a perception of equal loudness from 1,000 to 100 hertz, the 100 hertz level has to be hotter on a meter, okay? And 50 hertz usually has to be hotter than that to get enough 50 hertz output from a speaker in terms of our perception, right? So there's this weird disconnect between what you see on a meter and what you actually do in a mix to create a balanced spectrum, if you will. So if you add too much bass, too much of that very low frequency information, you will eat up a lot of headroom. But if you don't have enough bass, of course, then you end up with a signal that sounds too thin, like it doesn't have enough low end. So you can kind of understand how I would say it's important that you can actually hear what's going on down there, first and foremost. Because if you can't, it's hard to calibrate to how much is too much and how much is too little. So that's kind of point A. Point B I would make is that once you can hear that, you have to figure out a way to manage the relationship between the momentary push in the bass, that's usually a kick drum, and the sustain of the bass, right? So if you think of the low end in a mix as a single event, and for those of you who are familiar with the term ADSR, I might even think of it as sort of an ADSR envelope. Here, let me get rid of this and see if I can illustrate this point. Select, nope, no. See, I'm a novice using this tool. Select all, there we go. All right, so if you think of every bass event in a mix having an attack phase, decay, sustain, and release, right? So we want to manage the low frequency transient compared to the low frequency sustain so that the peak rises far enough above the sustained level so we feel the push of air every time the kick drum hits, but not so much that it eats up all of that low frequency information coming from the speaker, and it also might overshadow the sustain of the bass instrument itself. So the way to approach that is by using a combination of compression, and maybe you want to sort of take down the attack just a tiny bit on a kick drum if it's poking out too much. Maybe you want to compress a bass so that the attack of a bass that coincides with the beginning of a kick. The beginning of the bass doesn't rise up so far above the kick drum, but then you hear the sustain trailing after the kick drum. And in getting a tight kick drum and bass, sometimes a little bit of side chaining so that a kick drum will duck the beginning or the very first articulation of the bass. And then when the kick drum stops, the bass rises and follows the kick drum so that they work well together. That's a strategy that you can use to help you control the low end. Another sort of thing to say about this in managing low end, and this is coming from a mastering engineer's perspective, is that feathering out a little bit of energy from 40 hertz and down is something that I find myself doing quite commonly. I'll take a shelving equalizer and just taking 2-3 dB from 50, 40 hertz and down. There's not very much musical information below 40 hertz. 40 hertz is the fundamental frequency of low E on a bass guitar. In general, you're not going to find, unless you're recording a harp or a pipe organ, there's just not that much energy down there. Or the harp and pipe organ duets are my favorite genre. Anyway, but be careful about just taking out all the bass because it gives you a louder sound, you know, especially if you're using a high pass filter. That will cause a certain kind of scarring to the audio, and it'll harm it. And that low frequency support that you get in that first octave from maybe 50 to 100 hertz, if it's in proportion to everything above it, it's what gives the richness and the foundation for the rest of a mix. So a couple of thoughts about that. Hope that helps.
Cool. I want to get to a couple of the questions from the live chat that have come in. This first one is from Vincent, and he wanted to know what the best way to downsample is.
The best way. It's hard for me to answer that question without knowing a little bit more. I have my favorite sort of downsampling tools that I use. Mm-hmm. Not all sample rate converters are equal or behave exactly the same way. But I guess I'll try to answer the question in a sort of general way rather than talking about specific tools themselves. And that is to say, maintain the best fidelity that you can until the very end. Make sure you record at, you know, the highest sample rate that makes sense to you. Render everything at least a 24, if not 32-bit float resolution, and then wait until you've got your mix file done to your satisfaction. And then at that point, when you're done with your mix and your master, do your sample rate conversion at the very end. That's the best way to manage that transition down to the lower sample rates.
Cool. There was another question about sample rate that came in. It's from Kevin, and he wanted to know if you're mixing a session at 44/100, does it make sense to up the sample rate to say 88/2 for plug-in processing purposes, or is it a waste of space on the hard drive?
In general, I think people, if you're starting at 44/1 or 48, it rarely makes sense to upsample everything and mix at a higher sample rate. It does make sense to mix at 24 and with 32-bit floating point processing. But to upsample doesn't necessarily make sense. You will notice a number of peak limiter tools will automatically upsample or oversample, and they'll offer oversampling capability to help you manage the intersample peaks. And there's some EQ plugins that will automatically upsample to process and then downsample at the output of the EQ. So sometimes that can happen in isolated instances within each plugin or within each piece of outboard.
Cool. I wanted to get to some of these industry questions because I thought some of these were pretty interesting. This first one is from Adam, and he would like to know, any advice you wish you'd been aware of sooner, favorite books on audio or go-to reference tracks that you used kind of coming up in the mastering realm?
Sure. Well, let me sort of do this in reverse order. Reference tracks. On the iZotope Education account on Spotify, I think it's iZotope_education, we have a playlist of reference tracks, and they are reference tracks not just of great masters, but also great mixes that come down through time. So I would refer folks to that. I do have some specific records that I use to help me understand low end in a room. There's a record by Soul Coughing that was from the mid-90s. It was their first record, Ruby Vroom, V-R-O-O-M. The very opening of that record helps me understand calibrating low end in a mix. There are a number of records. There are examples on that playlist, so I direct you to that. The second part of that question was about books. All right, I'm going to give you three books. One book is a book about setting up loudspeakers and reproduction systems by Floyd Toole, T-O-O-L-E. And I think it's called something like Loudspeakers or something like that. It's a comprehensive book. It's dry, but it's got some selected chapters in it that are absolutely fantastic to help you think about setting up playback systems. So that's thing number one. Book number two, if you want an encyclopedia of digital audio, get Ken Pohlman's book. And his last name is P-O-H-L-M-A-N-N. He's a professor at the University of Miami, and his book about digital audio is comprehensive and amazing and fantastic. And then the third book, and it's not technical at all, is it's one of my favorite easy reads about the music industry, is by Jacob Schlichter from Semisonic. And it's about being out and being on tour and about the industry, and it's very informative and really accessible and well-written. So there's a few ideas about books. I wrote a book. Actually, I have a book about audio mastering too. So there's that, but I'm not going to claim that's my favorite. It's the only one I suffered through writing. and then advice. You know, I guess there are two pieces of advice that I always have taken to heart. One is I had a teacher at a very early age. He was teaching a class on audio tech and soldering. And he said to me, never tell anybody you're good at soldering if you hate doing it, because it's one of those things that people will ask you to do over and over again. So don't get good at something you don't want to do. So that was thing number one. The other piece of advice I guess I would give anybody is just remain curious. Keep pushing the boundaries. Keep testing your assumptions about the tools that you use and your own work. That's the only way that you grow and develop and push things forward. It's important sometimes to get into a groove with our tools and our monitoring environment so that you can get work done. But it's also really easy to fall into a rut. You keep making the same EQ moves every time you see a drum kit because that's what you do with drums. Well, not all drums are the same, and someday you might want to do something different, or you might discover that a different approach actually improves your work. So really sort of fighting. There's good habit, like naming files, session organization, and so on, but there are also certain kinds of habits that I think fall into the category of being ruts.
What are some events or situations that helped you pursue audio as a career? And this question's from Keith.
So what helped me pursue audio as a career? For me, there wasn't a choice. You know, the fact of the matter was there wasn't a choice. This is what I was going to do. I was so turned on by the marriage of audio and technology that I knew I needed to figure out some way to be involved with it. And I was involved from an early age in the music sort of making and producing art side of things. And as I was practicing, I gathered more and more technical skills and technical prowess and experience. But for me, it just wasn't an option to do anything else. So I think that as a result, I was always looking for opportunities to acquire new skills, always looking for opportunities to learn about new technology and keeping my eyes on trends. you know, when I started working as a mastering engineer, digital mastering was this sort of new magical thing, and digital audio was a new magical thing. These days, if you are coming into mastering, I think you're coming into a much, you know, a highly populated field, and a lot of people know something about it. And so it's not, it doesn't have this sort of new exotic flavor to it. It's also a much more crowded field, but there are things, there are places in audio that are these sort of new frontiers and boundaries of audio. So like audio for VR, 3D and spatial audio, audio that people can interact with in environments on the web and so on. So there are a lot of places where you might investigate and be open to new possibilities in ways that remind me very much of what it was like for me when I was starting as a mastering engineer.
Cool. This next one is from Dennis. He's on the live chat, and he wanted to know what important facts should you take into consideration when mastering for iTunes?
Cool. So, yeah, mastering for iTunes, it's a relatively simple proposition. The thing that mastering for iTunes offers is the possibility of creating a lossy file. You know, iTunes uses AAC files, which is a version of lossy file, much like an MP3. But they will allow you to submit a 24-bit file and even a 96 kilohertz 24-bit file from which the lossy, the AAC file, is produced. So in that sense, if you're starting with a higher resolution file before it gets converted, you will end up with a better converted file. The second thing is, Master for iTunes requires you to think about peak level. And when you convert a file, a mix file that's in AIF or WAV form into MP3 or AAC, there's a little bit of miscalculation that shows up in the peak level. And if your peaks are too high, the MP3 or AAC will distort. So Mastered for iTunes asks you to think about the peak level, adjust the level down so there's not so much distortion on the peak, and the AAC file will therefore sound a little bit better. So that's really the whole, very generally speaking, the basis of Mastered for iTunes. Parenthetically, my hope is that we're slowly but definitely moving away from lossy files in distributing audio over the web. You know, there's several platforms now that are offering either sale of lossless files or even streaming of lossless files out there. And I think that's happening more and more as the infrastructure of servers and pipes into people's homes supports higher bandwidth.
Kind of on the same topic, Alex would like to know what happens to your master when you send them to like Spotify or iTunes. How much is the volume changed?
Well, how much the level, and let me say two things. First of all, volume doesn't really have meaning with audio. We talk about loudness, and loudness is totally a phenomenon that happens in your ears. Loudness doesn't happen on a meter. All right, there's a relationship between the level on the meter and a playback control level that results in loudness, and that relationship is important. So when we talk about how loud something is, some people will say, well, how loud should it be on a meter? It's not loud on a meter, it's loud on playback. So when you play back from Spotify, Spotify tries to play back everything at the same level so that going from one single to the next, it sounds like it's at the same loudness, right? In a way that's not completely unlike what used to happen with FM radio. We have multiband compressors and we try to restrict dynamic range and then play everything back at the same level. So same is true with Spotify, with YouTube, with Tidal. And what they will all do is look at a mix, evaluate it based on level, give it a number and say, well, your mix is at this level. Our playback is at this level. So we're going to change the level by X amount. You know, if you're mix is set to a level of minus 10 LKFS, then YouTube is going to say, well, okay, if that's minus 10, we play back at minus 14, so we're going to turn it down 4 dB. So it depends on what your starting point is, how much the level is going to change.
This next one is from Nick on the live chat. Aside from peak level and peak distortion, what factors in to the signal path or production chain that causes issues with MP3 or AAC codecs?
Well, I'll try to go through this quickly. I as much as I think it's interesting to think about optimizing signals for MP3 or AAC, really at the end of the day, I think great sounding mixes stand the chance of translating best to any format, whether it's vinyl or what have you. Having said that, MP3 and AAC encoders will throw away information that you're least likely to miss. So if you have a lot of out-of-phase information between the two channels, you will probably notice a bigger change when the signal goes through an MP3 or AAC encoder, because it'll take away some of the different signal more than it will treat the mono signal. In fact, many MP3 encoders are mid-side encoders, and they work harder on the sides. It'll, depending on the bit rate, it will affect your high-frequency information. So just be listening for what happens to the top end. And the relationship between level into an encoder and the way the bass comes across is just something else to listen for. So I think that's kind of all I want to say about that. But managing your dynamic range and managing your mono compatibility are important when producing audio that will result in a good MP3. So let's go to some more of the sort of transition to some of the other kinds of technical questions. Let's see. I remember somebody actually asking a question that says, how can I go from a mix that's minus 16 to one that's minus 8 without distortion? Is that something that shows up there? And I want to answer that question by saying the following. If you need to get your mix to the point where it's minus 8 and you're starting at minus 16 and you only have 2 dB of headroom because the kick drum is punching too high or you have really big dynamic range in a mix, you might not... Getting where you need to go is going to involve a series of compromises. You are going to have to be strategic in minimizing the damage, but you can't get there without compromises. You can't get there without damage. That's just the truth of the matter. You don't get something for nothing. So some strategies you can use are by using gentle compression, by using a little bit of limiting, sometimes by using two stages of limiter, sometimes by rolling out a little bit of deep bass to clear up some headroom for you so you can push something up without hitting a limiter as hard. Those are all strategies that you can use, but really, at the end of the day, it's all about the art of compromise. And I think that that's one of the things that really highly skilled engineers get good at, is how to hide the artifact of the processing, right? There have been a number of questions that I also saw that people had asked that involved this idea of harshness. You know, how do I produce audio that doesn't sound so harsh or that has that analog depth, I think was a phrase that I read at one point. And as I was reading those, a couple of things came to my mind. First of all, the more processing you do, the more distortion you add to a signal. So if you do lots and lots and lots and lots of EQ, you may shape the tone the way you want it. But you're also going to accumulate high-frequency energy that comes from distortion. So if you want sort of good, transparent, deep, smooth audio, I would refer people sometimes to think about the quality of the sound that you're starting with, making sure that you get a capture that sounds as good as possible, or that you're choosing sounds that fit your end result. Without having to do a lot of compression and EQ and manipulation. Think about the arrangement. Think about the quality of the thing that you're starting with. So that's one thing. As far as, you know, once you've got everything captured and you want to create a sound that's not very harsh, what most engineers, experienced engineers, I think, find themselves doing the majority of the time is little bits of subtractive EQ. Rather than trying to kind of muscle EQ and tone shifting into a sound to contort it, to get it to where you want it, usually hearing what you want to hear, if you can get to hear to the point where you're hearing what you want to hear by taking out a little bit of something that's getting in the way, that you'll end up with a more transparent, deeper, more satisfying, more natural sounding result. I think the art of EQing very often involves just subtractive EQ, little bits at a time to kind of reveal the thing that you want to hear better. And I think if you rely more on that strategy rather than trying to force low end or force top end or force presence into a sound, that you'll end up with something that sounds by and large less harsh. So I think I just answered like three questions or eight at once, but so let's take like three more.
Sure. This one's from Matt, and he says a lot of folks use an 1176 and an LA-2A compressor in series for vocals. What technique do you use for vocals?
Yes, so the 1176 and the LA-2 are kind of the two of the grandmothers of all compressors in a way, right? I mean, there's a design topology, the way that they work, that are two of the sort of prototypes for other compressors. So an 1176 has a hard knee, has a, generally speaking, a very fast attack and a pretty fast release, and it's also it's got a fairly linear response to it. So an 1176 is good for catching quick peaks. So that's what that tool is good at. The LA-2 is soft knee, is opto. It has a nonlinear, smoother release. It's good for smoothing out longer term dynamic changes. So by using the two in series, you can address two different kinds of problems and end up with some good sort of solid dynamic control. By varying the attack times and release times on two compressors in series, you can also create a nice smooth dynamic range control without hearing the signature of either one of those compressors, because they tend to kind of interact and smooth each other out. So whether it's an 1176 or an LA-2 or some other version of a hard knee and a soft knee compressor or an opto compressor, using the two of them in combination is very powerful. Remember, compression is really just gain riding, right? You can do some interesting things with tone control and adjusting envelope with instruments, also with compressors. But if you look at a mix session by Tony Maserati or Miles Walker, or you know, some of the folks who are really well known for dealing with vocal-driven R&B and hip-hop and pop music, you'll see a ton of gain riding before they even start compressing. There's a lot of manual adjustment because that's the highest fidelity solution, right? If you could get all the level riding just with a fader, then you're not hearing any artifact from the compressor itself.
Cool. For this one's from Tom, and he wanted to know how to create analog depth in a professional master.
Yeah, I think I sort of talked a little bit about that when I was talking about EQ strategies and avoiding distortion and so on. Analog depth, what does that really mean? What is the advantage of analog? And I'm not sure whether he's talking about analog tape or he's talking about analog signal processing. And they're two very different things. I will say, I think the thing that analog anything gives you compared to just working purely in digital is there's this natural rounding off of transients that happens. And so if you are trying to mimic analog, it's getting good at using dynamic range control, either soft limiters or compression, just to help smooth out the transients. We don't necessarily want to hear compression, but we want to just take down some of those peaks so they're not poking into our ears and rising up as high above the sustained level. So I think I'll leave that one there.
Does loudness units full scale factor into Headroom?
So LUFS?
Yeah.
So LUFS is a way of measuring average level that incorporates a psychoacoustic model. And LKFS is even more to that point. So LUFS is a scale that connects directly to our perception. The fact that we will be more sensitive at mid-range frequencies than we are at the very edges of the audible spectrum, the very low end or the very top end. So LUFS definitely has a relationship to peak level in the same way that average or RMS level is related to peak level. So that's the relationship there. You know, there are a couple of things here. I'm looking at some of these questions, trying to kind of understand them. Some conversation about vinyl. Let's see if there's anything else. Let's get one more.
Todd on the live chat had a question. Are plugins that aren't designed to emulate hardware sensitive... Are plugins that aren't designed to emulate hardware sensitive in the same way because of floating point? Sorry, I'm missing part of that.
Well, if I can try to interpret the question, at least the first part of it, maybe I will say, so what are different... When you create a plugin that's looking to emulate hardware, you know, how successful is that endeavor? Maybe that's something that I find especially interesting, because, you know, we're always looking at these sort of pictures on a screen that show us an 1176, and then it says 1176, and then you turn the knob, and does it sound just like an 1176, or does it not? And if it doesn't, why doesn't it? And I don't have a definitive answer to does it or doesn't it. And there are many different implementations of 1176 style compressors or LA2 style compressors. But the one thing that I think is challenging for plugin manufacturers is to recreate nonlinearity and chaos and the things that happen when you operate at the extremes of the devices. I think there are many excellent emulations of LA2s or 1176s when you're getting a dB or 2 dB of gain reduction, or when you're with Pultex, you know, when you're boosting and creating those nice, smooth, gentle curves to get some tone control. It's when you push those things to the extremes and they start to misbehave, that's much harder to emulate. So I think that some of the more interesting emulations and successful emulations are ones that try to represent some amount of misbehavior on the part of the tools. But if you are looking for a little bit of tonal character to change or looking for a little bit of squeeze, I would submit that by and large, they're very, very successful software-based emulations. And I'm not sure I caught the bit about floating point.
He actually did clarify a little better. Are plugins that don't emulate hardware subject to gain staging sweet spots.
I see. Thank you. Thanks, Todd. No, I think, you know, within some range of settings, anything that's not trying to emulate nonlinearity should have the same performance, whether you're sitting, you know, 15 dB down or 15 dB up from a starting point. You know, some other folks had asked a question, you know, is there such a thing as too little level? You know, it's obvious what too much level might look like when you're pushing something into the red and you're hearing distortion. In my experience, if you print mixes that are too low and you have to raise the level by more than, say, 12 dB, I'm picking a number out of a hat here, I begin to notice some artifacts from large amounts of gain needing to be added to signals. So if you're printing your level of your mixes or your audio where the peaks on average are sitting, you know, the peaks are sitting down at minus 30, you may have some small noticeable degradation of the audio at the end of the day, in spite of the fact that we have, you know, very high quality 32-bit floating point gain stages. There is added noise when we start to range audio up and down beyond a certain point. All right, so I know I said three questions like five questions ago, but I'm on a roll. So let's do one more, and then we will wrap up here. Let's see. Look at my handy computer. I said I wasn't going to do it, but I'm going to do it. All right, so, boy, this is a hard one. How much headroom is necessary in EDM? Well, I'm going to answer this question in two ways. One is to say that it's been my experience that every recording has its limits, no pun intended. And if you try to push the level up too much and you start to lose the liveliness and the transience, then you've gone too far. You know, EDM in some ways is its own animal. It's such a malleable sort of electronic art form that there's almost no requirement that it refers to any kind of naturally occurring acoustic event, right? So if you can shape and misshape the audio so you maintain the life and get the level to where it's sitting, you know, the average level to where it's sitting at minus 5 or minus 8, awesome. It's hard to do. A lot of EDM producers are concerned that if their tracks are played in a club setting, that it's not going to compare favorably against other tracks in a club setting. And in those instances, in those particular cases, it may be important to try to push the level up as high as you can get it within reason. And I've seen good sounding masters that sit at minus 5. I mean, it's kind of crazy, but they're few and far between. So if I'm going to err on the side of more or less, I would say just always listen to what happens, especially with the bass. Make sure that the track isn't breaking up. Make sure that you're not losing that low frequency transient and that you're not adding too much sizzle and sort of high frequency distortion as a result of using lots and lots of limiters. But I do sort of allow for electronic and electronica music to have maybe some different requirements as far as level setting are concerned. Remember, if your EDM track gets played on Spotify, it's going to get turned way down. And, you know, if you push the level too much, it's going to sound maybe this big when it gets played in that context. So keep that in mind. So with that, I hope everybody got a little bit of useful information. If I didn't touch your particular area or question, and maybe Lars and I can review what came in online, and we'll try to feed back in a few instances to some folks by email directly. And if you have a remaining appetite for other answers and want to send in more questions, please don't hesitate. Keep sending them in. You can send them in to headroom@iZotope.com. And I'll look forward to seeing you all hopefully next month with a topic to be announced, but it should be hopefully controversial. Anyway, thank you, Lars.
Thank you. Awesome. Thanks for everyone for tuning in.
Great. Have a great rest of March. I hope it's warm where you are, and we'll see you next time.